Rebels fans, it is I, Andy Gutierrez, walking you through your weekly 200-square-foot tour of the Lucasfilm headquarters. This week, Kanan and Ezra returned to Lothal and uncovered a game-changing secret. And now it's time to peel back the proverbial curtain and show you how it all came together. This is Rebels Recon. Kanan and Ezra head to Lothal to infiltrate an Imperial factory floor, but get a surprise visit from Grand Admiral Thrawn.
My visit is not an honor, however, but an investigation.
Trapped inside the factory, Kanan and Ezra get help from an unlikely ally in order to escape.
Make for the east vehicle pool. You'll find a walker there you can escape in.
After safely fighting their way out, the rebels learn the data they stole contains blueprints to a mysterious new ship.
Looks like some new kind of TIE interceptor, but this one has shields.
This week, Ezra and Kanan learn the secret identity of another fulcrum. I sat down with cast and crew to talk about how Lothal has changed since the Rebels were last there, the return of Ryder Azadi, how Kallus turned to the Rebellion, and a little more classic Star Wars video game talk. Check it out. In An Inside Man, we return to Lothal for the first time, and it seems like the Empire's gained a larger foothold. What can you tell us about what's been going on here?
This is something that's kind of been increasing over the course of the entire galaxy. We're trying to show how things are changing and getting worse everywhere. The oppression of the Empire is getting worse and worse and worse.
It's really become a war factory at this point. They've dropped all pretense of being there to help you, and the needs of the Imperial war machine have been amped up. It's just this big factory belching out smoke and producing AT-ATs and TIE fighters and whatever the Empire needs.
We also haven't seen Sumar since his farm was taken away in season one. How did he end up in this Imperial facility?
Oh, poor Sumar. The Empire has basically made life for everyone there really difficult. You have to make a living, right? So if the only thing you can do is work for the Empire in this factory that they've built, you know, that's kind of what he has to do.
Right now, your biggest service to the Empire, if you're not a soldier, is just a cog in the machine, and that's what Sumar is doing. One of the points of inspiration for this was actually taking a look at the dehumanized factory workers in THX 1138. You become a number, you become the faceless, you don't have any individuality, and all that matters is that you're making machines.
This is also the first time we've seen Ryder in a while. Has he been leading an underground resistance on the planet?
Yeah, he's really trying to build a resistance. When the rebels left, there was really very little.
He's been a very busy man. He's the mole for the rebels, if you will, on Lothal, so he's trying to get any information, any intel, just any sort of inkling of what the Empire is up to, you know, whether it be small or huge.
It's also becoming clear that the Rebels have an ally in Imperial ranks. What can you tell us about that?
No, it's funny. It's like, you can't be too obvious with these things, apparently. There's a dramatic irony in it. It's like, did we know people were going to figure out it was Kallus? Yeah, we kind of figured. But the fan community is such that unless it's super obvious, there's always going to be a point of counterpoint and debate about it.
This is something we've been working towards for a few seasons. And that is a showing that, yeah, absolutely there would be people in the Empire who were spies. What's awesome is we've been able to show how a character who you really think is evil is, well, maybe not as evil as you might think.
Mm-hmm.
And you begin to understand why they would turn. You know, they got into a fight hoping to try to make the galaxy a better place. However, it's not turning out that way.
We get to see the inside of an Imperial facility. When designing a factory like that, do you give any thought to how all of it actually works?
Yeah, the conveyor belt that the sort of pieces of AT-ATs and TIE fighters are on was designed to, if you wanted to have it move, it could move. There was a door or gangway raised on the wall above that moving monorail. It didn't really get to do it in the episode because there was enough happening on the ground level that all of this extra business above would begin to get distracting.
The secret TIE fighter looks a whole lot like the TIE Defender, mm-hmm. which has been around since the old TIE fighter game. Is that the ship that we see here? Is that the Defender?
It is the Defender. We were all itching to get the Defender into the show.
We really wanted to make Thrawn a tactical leader. In realizing that the rebels are a growing threat, he's way ahead of the curve as far as planning for where they're going to end up. When he knows when he has the Defender ready and in mass production, just like Harris says in this episode, if they built this thing, we're in deep trouble.
For those of us who remember playing the TIE fighter game, it's a great ship. It's fast, it's got shields, it's got a hyperdrive. It sort of evens the odds, and you don't need hundreds and hundreds upon them to defeat just a small number of rebel starfighters. It evens the odds between the versatility of an X-Wing fighter and the limited capabilities of a TIE fighter.
Pablo Hidalgo. He's a complicated man. A man of many interests. A man of mystery. A man who may actually know more about Star Wars than you do. So let's go talk to Lucasfilm's own inside man about the wars taking place in the stars. The Star Wars, if you will.
Hey, Pablo.
Hello, Andy.
You're looking a little different today.
No idea what you're talking about.
Did you get new glasses?
Yeah, the glasses are brand new.
So now I'm going to ask you a social question then, because you are totally Pablo.
And that is my job as Pablo Hidalgo.
Yes, here we go. Daniel Laura Fabian asks, we've seen multiple characters with cybernetic eyes. Why does Kanan not have a pair of those?
Well, cybernetic eyes and cybernetic parts in general aren't cheap, and the Rebellion's hardly made of money. But in addition to that, he really wants to be able to rely on the Force and put his Jedi skills to good use.
All right, that makes sense. Thanks, Pablo.
No problem, Andy.
Have more questions about an inside man or any other Rebels questions you want answered? Tweet them to @StarWars using the hashtag RebelsRecon and we'll answer what we can online. But now it's time for an exclusive peek at our next episode.
Visions!
And
voices!
The Recon team leaves as soon as we're loaded up. Questions?
Is Admiral Thrawn there?
We have reports of an increase in capital ships, but no confirmation as to whether he's there.
Ezra, what is it?
Hey, kid, you feeling all right?
There! Look!
What am I looking at?
You don't look very good.
Ezra, what do you see?
Ezra!
Thanks for watching Rebels Recon. We'll be back next week with a brand new episode. But in the meantime, check out the episode guide for an inside man on StarWars.com on Monday. And if you haven't already, like the video, subscribe to the channel, and download the Star Wars app. Thanks for watching, and may the Force be with you.